Students, today we are going to start with the next chapter, coordination compounds. Okay, so we are beginning with coordination compounds. Some idea you must be having about coordination. We have studied types of bonds, but before I go into coordination, I will take types of salts. Okay. There are three types of salts. Types of salts. See, there are three types of salt. Which three types of salts are there? Number one, simple salt. Simple salt. Simple salt is that common salt which we use in the kitchen. NaCl, that rock salt which we are using. You are using so many other salts in the lab, potassium chloride, you are using sodium sulfate. These are all simple salts. Now, what is a simple salt? Simple salt is that in which you have one cation and anion. Not necessarily one cation and one anion. There will be cation and anion. And between cation and anion, there will be, you know, force of attraction, that is ionic bond. Okay, so basic characteristic property of the simple salt is, when you put this in water, when you dissolve this in water, it will separate into ions. It will form sodium aqueous, chloride aqueous. Both will dissociate. And if you go for the test, it will give the test for sodium ion as well as chloride ion. Got it? Now, you can take some other salt also. Suppose I take potassium sulfate. Potassium sulfate will ionize when you dissolve this in water. When you put this in water, it will ionize as 2 potassium and 1 sulfate ion. How many potassium, how many sulfate will be formed? That depends upon the valencies. Because this was 2 minus, you got 2 potassium just to balance it. So this will give the confirmatory test of potassium ion, sulfate ion. This will give the test for sodium ion, chloride ion. It's a simple salt. Simple salt will have cation and anion. One type of cation and one type of anion. That is a simple salt. Okay. I hope you, this idea is clear now. Second type of salt. Second type of salt is double salt. Double salt. Now, as the name only says, double salt. There will be 2 salts in it. Very common example which you get of this is, which you use in the lab. In practicals also we use Mohr salt. Now what is Mohr salt? It is potassium sulfate. No, sorry. I was writing alum. It is ferrous sulfate, ferrous ammonium sulfate. Ferrous sulfate. Then you have ammonium sulfate. And 6 water molecules. Okay. Ferrous ammonium sulfate. So ferrous ammonium sulfate, when you put it in water, when you put this in water, when you dissolve this in water, it will give ferrous ion, it will give ammonium ion, it will also give sulfate ion. Got it? So that means double salt is that which will be a mixture of 2 separate ionic salts. Between ferrous and ammonium sulfate, there won't be any force of attraction. There are 2 different types of salts which are combined together. But one property is, when you dissolve this in water, it will separate into ions. All ions will separate. That means it will give a test for ferrous ion, it will give for ammonium ion, it will give for sulfate ion. This is one example children have taken for Mohr salt, for double salt. Second example for the double salt we can have is, you know, alum. Alum is a double salt. Potassium sulfate. Then you have aluminium sulfate. And then you have 24 water molecules. Water of crystallization is associated with it. Okay, alum. You will have 1 monovalent ion in this and 1 trivalent ion. So it will give, when you put this in water, when you put this double salt in water, it will form potassium ion, it will form sulfate ion, it will form aluminium ion. That means all ions get separated out. But one thing is, the difference between the two, this will have only one type of cation, one type of anion. This will have combination of two ionic salts, and between two different ionic salts there won't be any force of attraction. They are just combining together. If you take ferrous sulfate solution and ammonium sulfate solution and you mix them in a proper equimolar ratio and you dissolve this in water and allow it to crystallize, you will get ferrous or this thing, ferrous ammonium sulfate is more salt crystals, you will get it in the lab. This also you have one of the experiment. Okay, you have another example of this as carnelite. Carnelite. Now what is carnelite, children? Potassium chloride, magnesium chloride, 6 water molecules. Okay, so you will have potassium ion, chloride ion, magnesium ion. All tests will be given by this. Okay, so two types of salts I have taken, children. Third type of salt. Third type of the salt which we will be dealing in this is complex salts, or these are also called as coordination salts. These are coordination compounds. Okay, now what are these? Let me give example for this, then I think it will be clear. If you take this, a K4FeCN taken 6 times. Okay, now there is one sphere. We will be talking about this in detail separately, but just to give you an idea, I'm giving, there will be a square bracket. The part inside the square bracket will not undergo ionization, that remains intact. That means if I put this in water, it will form, the part which is outside the bracket is going to ionize. So 4 potassium ions are outside, they will ionize. Then you have one complex ion, that is FeCN, taken 6 times, 4 minus. That means when you perform the test, you will not get the test for Fe. You will not get the test for Cl. You will only get the test for potassium ion in this. Got it? So it is a complex salt. What all types of bonds are there in it? They are all 3 types. Ionic, covalent and coordinate. That is dative bond. How? Between potassium, this cation and anion, this part is anion. Between them, ionic. Between carbon and CN, covalent. Between CN and Fe, there is dative bond. So sometimes even these questions can be asked. What type of bonds exist in this? You get all categories of bond. Ionic, covalent and dative bond. This is clear, children? One example I have taken. One more I will take. You take this example, even this one you deal with in the lab. That is CuNH3 taken 4 times, SO4. Okay. Now this part is complex. This part is a sphere. This part will not undergo ionization. So how will this ionize now, children? This will ionize as CuNH3 taken 4 times charge. I will be talking about how are you getting these charges and all later part of this chapter. But as of now, you have some idea about what sulfate is. 2 minus charge, so the complex will have 2 plus charge. Okay, we will be further coming to it. And one sulfate ion means basically what idea I'm giving you in the beginning is coordination compounds are those which will have a coordination sphere, will have all kinds of bond. The part which is inside the bracket will not undergo ionization. Okay, so as of now we have discussed 3 types of salts. You can note down this, please. Let us continue with Werner's theory of coordination compounds. Actually, all the details of the coordination compounds were explained by Werner. You need to understand it very nicely because this forms the base of the chapter now. Okay, I will explain all the postulates taking example. I am taking a common example of K4FeCN taken 6 times. Now, one thing, children, what he said was the part which is outside the bracket, the part that is outside the bracket is called as primary valency. You can go on writing what I am saying. Okay, what is the primary valency? Primary valency is that part which is present outside the square bracket. Outside the square bracket. That means the part here, potassium. How many potassiums are there? 4 potassium. So what is the primary valency in this particular compound? 4 primary valencies are there. Potassium. here. And one more thing, all points about primary valency we can write. Primary valency, since it is outside the bracket, we can say that it is ionizable. The part outside the bracket we are saying, this is ionizable. That means when you dissolve this particular complex in water, then these ions will be detected. If you are performing a test, you will be able to perform the test for potassium. Now, another thing. This part which is inside the bracket, this sphere, in fact, you call this sphere as coordination sphere. You call this as coordination sphere. The parts inside means FECN, these are all coordination entities which are there inside. Okay, this sphere, we call this as coordination sphere. In the coordination sphere, children, there will be two things. One, there will be a central metal ion. There is a central metal ion. And normally you will find that the central metal ion is a D block element. It is D block element. Or which we also call as transition elements. Of course, the difference between transition and D we will be studying. But this is D block. Why D block element here? When we will further study, we will find that this central element takes electron. It takes electron, and D block element will have a tendency to take electron because it has vacant D orbital. It has vacant d orbital. That is why it can act as a Lewis acid. We will be talking about this also. It is taking electron. Next part. There is one more part here. Inside the bracket, there is one central atom, we said. Apart from that, there is some other species present. This is secondary valency. Apart from the central metal ion, what is present inside the bracket? This is called as secondary valency. The secondary valency is non-ionizable. It is not going to undergo ionization because, as I said, this whole thing is a sphere. This will remain intact even if you are putting this in water. This will not undergo ionization. This is non-ionizable. Another thing. This also helps us in detecting what is the coordination number. Coordination number means how many surrounding ligands, we will be talking about this term, present in the central metal ion which are giving electron. Secondary valencies are all giving the electron pairs to the central atom. Is this part clear? Next thing. The secondary valency or the coordination number decides the geometry of the complex. It decides the geometry, helps us in detecting what will be the geometry of the complex. Because that part which has undergone ionization will not decide the geometry. The part which is inside, that is the secondary valencies, will decide the geometry. How? We will be further studying, but as of now I am telling, if you have coordination number, and what will be the geometry part, if I say geometry, then if the coordination number is 2, then they will be so arranged that the repulsion is minimum. Something like what we talk about in chemical bond. If this is 3, then we say it is trigonal planar. About hybridization also, based on different theories we are going to talk about. If coordination number is 4, children, it can be either tetrahedral or it can be also square planar. Square planar, how, when, we will be considering. If it is 5, then it is trigonal. If I just draw the geometry, I hope it will be clear. Trigonal bipyramidal. If it is 6, this side I am writing. If it is 6, it will be square bipyramidal. If I draw like this, it will be square bipyramidal, or we also call this as octahedral. It is octahedral. Till here it is clear. What is the primary valency? The part that is outside the bracket. Then there is a sphere. In the sphere there are two things. Central metal ion, which is normally a D block element. It can be iron, it can be copper, it can be mercury, it can be zinc, or many more examples we'll be talking about. Then apart from the central metal ion, what is present is the secondary valency, which is not ionizable. Very, very important. It decides the geometry. It will be also considered as the coordination number. Okay, and this part which is there inside the bracket will not dissociate further. Till here you write down, and this geometry also you can write, then we will be further taking some more examples. Now let us take some more examples for better understanding. Now suppose I am taking this, I am not naming here as of now because I have not taught you the nomenclature. We will take nomenclature separate class. Now I am just talking about what will be the primary valency, what will be the secondary valency, and how many ions will it form. Okay, so let us write. This part is outside the bracket. This shows the primary valency. So what is the primary valency here? I am writing here, what is the primary valency, children? I am going to write what is the secondary valency here and how many ions will be formed. Okay, so primary valency outside the bracket is primary valency 1. Secondary valency inside, apart from the central metal ion, what is there? 4 NH3s are there. So what is the secondary valency? 4. If this is dissolved in water, how many ions will it form? Let me write the ions. With that, I think it will be clear. If I write, it will form Cu NH3 taken 4 times 2 plus 1 plus 1 sulfate ion. There will be 2 ions formed. Got it? The number of the ions formed is 2. In this, this is only having a sphere, nothing else. So it doesn't have a primary valency. One more thing, children, you can add there. Their primary valency is must, it will be present. Sorry, secondary valency will be present. Primary may or may not be present. Because in this case, nothing present outside. So no primary valency. So we will say primary valency is 0. And secondary valency here is 4. There are 4 COs attached to Ni. In a way, we can further say these 4 COs are giving its lone pair of electron to the central atom Ni. We will be talking about the nomenclature part. Then we will see. And these ions in water, nothing. It's not going to ionize. So primary may or may not be present. Secondary will be present. This 3 Cl's present outside the bracket. So primary valency is 3. 3 NH3s apart from central metal ion, we do not consider in secondary valency. Okay, this is central metal ion. And 6 NH3s are there. So secondary valency is 6. How many ions will it form? Let me write it. CONH3 taken 6 times 3 plus 3 Cl minus. That means it is forming 4. 4 ions are there. 1 complex ion and 3 chloride ions. Primary valency. This primary may be present afterwards. It can be present before. Anywhere it can be present. Based on that, we name the complexes as cationic, anionic. I'll be taking about this in the next video. So, what is the primary valency? 2. Outside the bracket. Inside, apart from the central atom, 4. Secondary valency is 4. How many ions are formed? Outside the bracket is K. 2 Ks are there. So, 2K plus 1 Hg I4. This will be 2 minus because this 2 minus has gone here, means the charge is 2 minus. Okay, next. So total ions formed here will be 3. Next one here. Outside the bracket, 1. Primary valency is 1. Inside, apart from the central atom, 2. Secondary valency is 2. How many ions are formed put together? Ag, NH3 taken twice plus 1 charge plus 1 Cl minus. So the total number of ions here, 2. Nothing. If it is a neutral complex, no ions will be formed. In the third example, children, 4. In this example, 3. In this example, 2. This is very important for understanding, you know, on this basis itself, so many questions can be asked. One more, I mean, we will be talking about. Sometime they ask with respect to the salt analysis, whether this will give so and so tests and all that. Please note down. Now, another, you know, pattern of the question as I was discussing, suppose these, this is a textbook question, NCERT question, these are some compounds given to you. And suppose it is said, when you add silver nitrate, as you know, what is the test for halogen? We add silver nitrate to the soil solution, you get a curdy white precipitate of AgCl. So, to all these complexes, AgNO3 is added. When you add AgNO3, this is given in the question that these many moles of AgCl are precipitated using AgNO3. Means, to this, if I add AgNO3, I am getting 2 moles of AgCl precipitated. What do we conclude by this? We conclude that these many chlorides are outside the bracket. That is why they are able to ionize. That is why they are able to give a precipitate with AgNO3. So, I will write first a complex to show you that these are outside the bracket. So, what we will do, what complex will be written? PD. Cl will not be inside the bracket because there are 2 Cls and both are getting precipitated. So, we will write NH3. This is 4 times outside the bracket you will have this. The question is that assign secondary valency to it. Okay, but I am telling you both. This will be outside, that means this is responsible for the primary valency. Inside this is secondary valency. So what is the secondary valency here? This is secondary valency. Okay, so what is secondary valency here? 4. What is the primary valency here? 2. Likewise, 2 AgCls are precipitated and 2 are visible in the complex. That means this is not written in the complex form, but it appears as a complex. It is given in the question. So, 2 Cls are outside. So, what we will write? Ni, all waters will be inside the bracket and both the Cls will be outside because it is saying it is precipitating both. Suppose one was written, we will keep one Cl inside, one Cl outside. That case, water number will be varying. Okay, so this is the primary valency, this is secondary valency. So, 6 secondary valencies and 2 primary valency. Number we have to take. Number we have to take. How many outside? That is the secondary one. Now, next one. 0. No moles are precipitated. Means all the Cls are inside the bracket. All the Cls are inside the bracket. So, what is the complex? PT. Cl4 you will write. And then you will write HCl taken twice. All are inside the bracket. Sorry. All are inside the bracket. Nothing is outside. So, what is the primary valency? Nothing. 0. What is the secondary valency? 6, 2 HCls and this 4. Total 6. Here, 1 mole of AgCl is precipitated. Means 1 Cl is outside. What about the remaining? Inside the bracket. So, what is the complex? CONH3 taken 4 times. As many written here. 1 outside the bracket means 2 Cls you are going to put inside. 1 mole is outside, so 1 will be outside. So what is the primary valency? 1. What is the secondary valency? 4 plus 2. 6. Secondary valency here is 6. Secondary valency here was 6. Primary valency here was 2. Here primary valency was 2. Secondary valency was 4. Got it? Last one. 0. That means no Cls outside the bracket. All Cls are inside. PT. Then you have NH3 taken twice. Then you have Cl2. Nothing is outside the bracket. Nothing outside means no primary valency. Primary is 0. What is the secondary valency, children, here? 4. Because 2 NH3s and 2 Cl. Now you must be thinking, why I am writing NH3 first. We will be doing in the naming, they have to be written in the alphabetical order. But anyway, this you have an idea that with AgNO3, if these many moles are precipitated, it means those Cls will be outside. Sometimes they ask a question that when you add barium sulfate, barium chloride, for sulfate we do barium chloride test. When you add barium chloride, these many moles of barium sulfate are precipitated. With that reference also the question can be framed. Now please note down, this is all for today's video, and then next class we will be talking about the naming and all types of classifications of coordination compounds.